Good morning, everybody. I can imagine how all of you are feeling on a cold, wintry Sunday morning, being here to listen to us on something on skilling and talent management. But at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Garg for giving me the opportunity of being here. In fact, I've had this opportunity for the last couple of years, and I do enjoy speaking to all of you, especially the students who are here. And my compliments to him for sustaining this conference, and in this technical conference, always keeping a session on HR. Because you will all agree that it's not the business that creates the value, it's the people that create the value. So unless and until you have the right fit of people in an organization, no matter how much you may do, the key differentiator is the people and the human resource of the organization. So my compliments and thank you for giving us this opportunity. Okay. And this time he has enlarged the framework. Till the previous years, we were only speaking about skilling. Today it's the entire gamut, because with the kind of changes that are happening, the entire gamut of talent management has to be kept in mind and very carefully crafted by the leadership of the organization with the support of the entire organization. Because you will agree that business strategy is the hardware that drives the future organizations, but value-led and purpose-driven HR practices is the software that must drive sustainable and responsible growth. So how important is the human resource? And it's very important to have this human resource strategy aligned with the business strategy. And I was fortunate enough in the two organizations that I worked in, whether it was ONGC, where I was for 3 decades, in the HR, I was one of the persons who had drafted out the HR strategy. And when I was on the board and at the helm of things at EIL, I again insisted that we must have an HR strategy which is aligned with the business strategy. But unless and until you have the people ready at the time that you require, you really can't take on any action. It will be only there on paper. Now, as John F. Kennedy said, change is the law of life, and those who look only to the past or present are certain to miss the future. And it's not only change. I remember when we were in management school and we used to have a chapter on change management, it was only resistance to change and how do you manage it. Today it's not only change, it's the pace of change. In fact, today change is the new normal. It's something which is given and it's going to happen. What is constant is change today. But it's the pace of the change which today has to be kept pace with. And with these exponential technologies coming, the disruptive environment which is there today, if we don't keep pace with it, we are going to be left behind. Now, in this changing energy mix that we have, our industry is being impacted by disruptions because of the changing geopolitical relationships, increased competitors, changes in supply and demand dynamics, social and environmental pressure, demographic shifts, and rise of exponential technologies, as I just mentioned. And the factors which are going to impact all organizations, including the PetroCoal sector, are the economic changes which are taking place so fast. Disruptive technology, of course, is the one which is, and the rise of that, especially. Though in this sector, especially in the oil and gas sector, I come from oil and gas sector, so I'd speak more confidently about that. It's a highly data-intensive sector. So where that is required, all these areas, whether it's artificial intelligence, whether it's machine learning, they're going to be helping in building the cognitive advisors. The 3D printing, this is going to help in fast and cost-effective representation of assets. I'm sure you would have had a special session on AI and on the exponential technologies which are coming in, but just touching on them from the HR perspective, that what kind of changes we'll have to bring in our human resource. The Internet of Things is going to have an impact blockchain is going to come in gradually, but these advanced robotics are going to overcome a challenge of risk where they go offshore for inspections and so many other things where we could use them. Now, how are we going to have our people ready for that? Just to give you a small idea about what the future of organizations in general is going to be. As you must be seeing, things are shifting today. We don't have monopolies within the country today. There's tremendous competition, and everyone's going global. So we are working in small teams at various places, but the structures may be flat, the hierarchies may be flat, but at the same time, there has to be a lot of teamwork that is happening. Diversity is increasing. So all these changes which are taking place, how does the organization cope with it? And they're all those changes which are accepted today. So if any organization which is rising, which is doing well, which has ambitions to grow, says that we don't want to follow all this, it's not going to be possible. So how are you going to set your own targets for this? The energy industry is at heart of people's business, and energy resources are in focus on the world stage. But today we have an aging, we have an aging workforce. How are we going to do that knowledge transfer? How are we going to prepare for that? I'll skip some of these. On one hand, today we read in all newspapers and you talk everywhere that there's a shortage of jobs. But on the other hand, there is talent shortage too. Thank you so much. There is talent shortage too. And this talent shortage is in these niche areas. Because today, most of the youngsters, in fact, we have Dr. Ravinder Singh here from the, he's the CEO of the Mining Skill Development Council. And I have also been closely associated. I'm on the committee of FICCI and been doing a lot of work after my superannuation in the area of skilling. What we notice is that a lot of youngsters want to today get into retail and various other such areas, whereas in those tough areas which are there, whether it's drilling, whether it's production, oil and gas, all these areas, you're having a shortage of people. In the construction industry, there's a lot of shortage of people. There's talent shortage. And this is the scenario world over. So now, when I shift now on what organizations should do, I have flagged till now what are the issues. I like to quote Mahatma Gandhi when he said, the future depends on what we do in the present. So it's time for us today, organizations, to prepare for the future. We need to create an ecosystem to build a workforce for the future which is very agile. The two mantras today are agility and adaptability. The teams need to be very agile in our organizations. I'll talk about EIL. If we had chemical engineers who are process engineers, and tomorrow if you are diversifying into some area, you can't keep hiring new people. You need to have talent fungibility. So that is very important. So we need to build this kind of a workforce, ensure teams can handle any changes. Multiple work models to prevail. I'm sorry, I have a very bad throat. Apply science to enhance results. Data analytics. Create new jobs, new industries, and change the work style. It could be collaborative, it could be fragmented. We need to do upskilling. We already have skilled people because you must be aware there are three types of skills. One are the physical and manual skills. The other are the cognitive skills. And the third are the emotional skills. And now, the manual and the cognitive skills are more or less being taken care of. At least the basic cognitive skills are more or less being taken care of by the technologies. So now what is going to be left where we need to train our people now are the emotional and the high technology skills. So we need to upskill our people. Energy sector, highly interdisciplinary, and multiple skills are required there. So it's an integration of these disciplines which will be required, and there has to be mobility between sectors. Rotational training will have to be given importance. Mentoring and coaching at various stages to keep people abreast with what is the requirement. Global collaboration to be given impetus. And training for high-end equipments to be able to adapt to the technologies which are coming in. We have to have our best foot forward for that. So there could be multiple work models which would be required. The organization leadership has to decide on which one they would like to go, whether it's crowd servicing, technology or transaction processing, contract workers, full-time workers. You have to have a mix of them today. In fact, I'm happy that even public sector today has started moving towards mixed models. Earlier it was that we only had management trainees, we would hire them and they would retire after 35 years. But today we are outsourcing, in EIL also we had outsourcing, ONGC is adopting different models, so are other companies. Just to share with you that McKinsey Global Institute survey, they spoke to 3,000 business leaders. And in this changing scenario, the emphasis of the report is on continuous learning. An environment of learning has to be there within an organization. Shift to cross-functional and team-based work. Jobs to be redefined as tasks change. So now we have blue-collar and white-collar. There is a time coming, we will have to have something in the middle, a middle level. Companies to be more agile, as I said. Leadership and HR need to adapt, so again say agility and adaptability, and have sufficient knowledge of the adoption of automation. And this cannot be done alone. So the building the workforce for the future, all stakeholders need to be kept together. And that is where organizations and societies like FICCI and CII and all can really play a major role. Firms to collaborate with educators to be able to set the curriculum with them so that the students who come to the organizations are ready. And we don't have to spend one whole year on training them and orienting them before we get them onto the job. Industry to build a talent pipeline which could be used by various companies. Labor unions need to be kept on board to see that they allow mobility. Now there are examples where you have a dearth of some skill in a particular state, but the other states are not allowed to enter. We were doing this Dibrugarh project, the petrochemical project. We needed a number of thousands of welders there. There were no welders there, not a sufficient number. We tried to get from Odisha, they were not allowed to enter. So that kind of is the labor unions are going to help here. And governments to ensure smooth transition, encourage mobility, see about the pay scales and pay structures and other labor codes and labor acts to facilitate and make a facilitative environment. So all these benefits need to be looked into and keep all the stakeholders together. Towards the end, I'd just like to mention how the change is taking place. So in the next few years, gradually, the physical and manual, as I mentioned, skills, the requirement is going down and it's going to be coming to almost negative. The basic cognitive skills, which are only compilation of data, are also being taken over by the technology. But higher cognitive skills, which require creativity and analysis, data analytics, that is where we need to groom our people. Social and emotional leadership skills, soft skills, and the high technology that is required. So now our shift of organizations has to be towards these skills. So that is a change which needs to come over. There has to be a mindset shift, culture of learning, organizational setup, again, as agility I said, new color job, and the leadership has to adapt and orchestrate the change. There are many options. You could retrain, have advanced skills, you could redeploy your existing, hire acquire individuals or teams, contract, you could leverage on external workers, and also release, which of course in public sector parlance is not so easy, you can't release people so easily, but then you have to go for the outsource model for that. And I'd like to end with this slide, if you ponder on it, that the 2025 organization is going to focus on process excellence. It has to be a purpose-driven culture. You can't just have people sitting in your organization not knowing what the purpose is, not knowing what the objective is. So top to bottom, everyone must know what the vision of the company is, what the targets of the company are, where is the company leading to, because today is the time when you need to have everyone together with you. There has to be adaptive technology and very, very agile teams. Because the key differentiator in an organization is its human resource, and this is set, surely success will be there for the organization. Thank you very much.